I'm gonna sing, I'm gonna shout, I'm gonna let the reason out that his love goes on forever. I'm gonna take it all the way.
Hey, it's Thursday, October the 13th, 2022, and this is the Maple Minute, and I'm Pastor Bill, and we've been talking about how to build biblical quality friendships. And today we're going to talk about a model friendship. And we've looked at Jesus' characteristics of love and how friendship's defined by him, but we want to see it fleshed out in a story. In the Old Testament, we find the story of two guys, a guy named David and a guy named Jonathan, and they were probably the best friends that you could ever see in the Bible. In fact, the Bible says in 1 Samuel chapter 23, verse 15, while David was at Horesh in the desert of Ziph, he learned that Saul, that is the father of Jonathan, had come out to take his life. And Saul's son, Jonathan, went to David at Horesh and helped him find strength in God. Great verse there. And verse 17, it says, don't be afraid, he said, that is Jonathan speaking to David. My father Saul will not lay a hand on you. You will be the king over Israel, and I will be second to you. Even my father Saul knows this. Verse 18, the two of them made a covenant before the Lord. Then Jonathan went home, and David remained at Horesh. You know, as far as we know, that was the very last time that these two friends, these two close friends, these two biblical friends shared any time together. The death of Jonathan would come very soon, and it would permanently separate them. But if you don't know much about David and Jonathan in this little soap opera of a story, you would miss out on so much there. These were two of the most unlikely to ever become friends. They are an unlikely pair. You see, Jonathan was the heir apparent of his father Saul's throne. He was the next in line as the son to inherit the throne of his father Saul. But David, on the other hand, was God's chosen successor to Saul. Saul had failed to do what God had told him to do, and so he, through the prophet Samuel, was told that he would lose his kingdom to someone else, and that someone else was David. David was anointed as a young boy to become the next king, but he had to wait until he became the age of 30 before it happened. But along the way, God, I don't know if he had a sense of humor, but he knit these two potential enemies, these two what everybody thinks they should be feuding families, he knit these two men together into a wonderful showing of biblical friendship. And it beautifully portrays the essential features of what we want to know as what is quality friendship. What does it look like? And today we're just going to give a quick look at it, and I want to note five characteristics or five things we see about this friendship. Number one, my friend, and this is how we'd say about David and Jonathan, this is what quality friendship would look like. My friend is the one whose need I can meet, not the one who meets my needs. You see, when Jonathan went to meet David because Saul was chasing after him, he had everything to lose and nothing to gain from that. David, on the other hand, he was a fugitive. He was being sought by Saul to be killed. And by encouraging David, Jonathan was actually being a traitor to his father. He was aiding and abetting the enemy. But Jonathan saw a need in his friend David's life, and he reached out to meet it even at the cost of his own life. Jonathan was a giver. In fact, if you didn't know this, the name Jonathan, it means the Lord has given. And that characteristic is stamped all over his life, because back in those times, names meant a lot. All true friendships begin with a commitment to be a friend, not just to have a friend. And that's so much different than what we often think. You see, this is an attitude I need to cultivate in my life, and probably you do too, that a concern, it should be a concern to find not just my kind of people, but to find needs I can meet in other people's lives. And that's what makes us friends, to help meet somebody else's need, not to find someone who meets mine. Number two, we would say this, a friend encourages his friend in God. The actual Hebrew expression here in this passage is picturesque. He did not try to encourage David by minimizing his problem, saying, it's no big deal, David, he's not a very good hunter, he won't catch you. He didn't present himself either as the answer to David's problem. Well, David, I know my dad's hunting you, but I'm here, so you don't need anything else. No, he didn't do that. What did he do? The Bible tells us instead, Jonathan strengthened David by encouraging him directly to depend on God. He encouraged him in God. Jonathan enabled David to be a God-centered man, and this is the basic yardstick to measure the worth of friendships. So the question we should ask is your friend stronger in God because of the time he spends with you? Or is spiritual growth a side issue in your relationship? And that can be a problem, which wrecks your life if you're not careful. Number three, a friend is someone whom I share a deep common interest. A friend is someone with whom I share a deep common interest. The quality of friendship is nearly always determined by the quality of that which unites it. Because David and Jonathan's interests had depth to it, so did their friendship. Their friendship wasn't just a superficial, hey, we both like swords. No, it was more than that. They had their friendship knit in God first. See, a friendship is born out of the liking of many threads, or the linking of many threads in our lives, and the quality of those interests will reveal a great deal about the quality of your friendship. See, hey, if my friendship with someone is linked to get to them just because, well, hey, we both like football, well, that's cool, but what happens when football season's over? Not much. So the common interests, we need to have a common center that's even greater. So if you want to have a quality friendship with someone, have a higher purpose or higher interest between the two of you. Number four, a friend is someone committed to help his friend or her friend realize God's purpose and potential for his or her life. In chapter 23, we read this verse, but in verse 17, Jonathan said this about his friend. My father Saul will not lay a hand on you. How did he know that? He says, you will be king over Israel, and I will be second to you. Even my father Saul knows this. And so it's Jonathan becomes a prophet here. But he's giving an astonishing prediction, because he's basically saying, I know I'm supposed to be the next guy who's supposed to be king, but you know what? David, you're better, and I think God's on you, and so I'm going with God, and so I don't think I will be, even though my dad thinks so. Famous writer Dostoevsky once wrote, to love a person means to see him as God intended him to be. That's such a great definition there of love in our friendships. See, Jonathan helps us see that a friend not only sees a friend like that, but he also acts to bring the potential to reality. He sees what David could be, what David should be, and he does everything he can to bring it to reality. And that's why he was protecting David. Number five, and last of all, we find a true friendship involves declaring loyalty and commitment. Verse 18, it says, the two of them made a covenant before the Lord. The last thing they did before they were split up forever is they made a covenant. David and Jonathan didn't simply drift in and out of their friendships because they were separated by circumstances and all these other things. See, the practice of verbal commitment and encouragement is not one we find easy, especially, I'm just going to be honest, especially amongst men. We feel that's a girly thing. We don't want to do that, but it's true. And here's the really big predicament. As Christians, we find we delight in the fact that Jesus declares his love and friendship for us, but we don't like to do that to other people. See, as we do the same thing in our lives, it will strengthen our loyalty to our friends, and it really will help us in the end become better friends biblically. There's an old saying that says, whoever fears the Lord directs his friendships aright. I think that's a good truth there. As we fear God, it will help us move forward. So as we think it over, here's the questions we need to contemplate. Number one, what are the yardsticks you use to measure your friendships? Maybe you've never thought about them. Maybe you don't have any. Why? And if you don't have any, take some time to write some out. Start having a plan for your friendships. You'll find they grow better, or they're worthless and you probably need to discard them. Number two, is your friend stronger in God because of the time he spends with you? Or is spiritual growth a side issue in your relationship? Now, those two questions will help you understand whether that friendship needs to be reevaluated, reconstructed, or removed. And so I think that's important for us. And then last of all, to love a person is to see him as God intended him to be. That was a statement that Dostoevsky made. How do you see your friends? How do you think your friends see you? And how about God? How do you think God sees it? So take time, as always, to think these things through, journal them out, and be honest. If you're not going to be honest, then the Word of God won't help you, because it can't be built on lies. Lies are Satan's language, and we want to speak the truth. Just as always, we want to remind you that Maple Springs is in the business of leading people into a growing relationship with Jesus Christ. And so for you, we want you to move forward. we want you to help others before too. So if you take time to like our video, share them out, and even leave us some comments. If you'd like to have more questions answered, maybe a topic covered, we'd like to be able to do that for you. So until next time, thanks for joining us here at the Maple Minute.
Gonna praise Jesus' name, 'cause His love goes on forever. His love reaches to the high.